Julius Stutchbury is emerging as one of the leaders of the new generation of Australian architects. He's recognized for his innovative approach to sustainability and design. A principal of the firm Peter Stutchbury Architecture, he's practiced independently since 1981, producing a wide variety of work. Projects have been published and acclaimed internationally. Peter has taught both nationally and internationally, and he's currently a professor at the University of Newcastle, Australia, and one of the distinguished masters with the Architecture Foundation Australia, which runs the Glenn Merkert Masterclass and other such workshops. Time spent living in the desert country of Western New South Wales during Peter's formative years allowed him to develop an appreciation of the logic behind Australian landscape and the sensitive nature of its sustainability. He aspires to elevating the status and respect that our wider environment deserves into the day-to-day culture of architecture disciplines. In 2001, Peter Stutchbury's work was a major contributor to the University of Newcastle winning the Australian Prime Minister's National Environmental Banksia Award for Sustainable Development. It's a rare privilege, Peter, that you're here with us today, and I consider myself really lucky to call you a friend. Thanks for coming. Please, if you could.
This talk today is a result of being asked to present sort of a summary of my work from day one to now. So not by the institute here in India, but by the institute in Australia. So it's not a usual talk of mine where I might concentrate on one or two jobs, a summary talk. And it tries to pick up on the lessons that were learnt by each particular work and each particular experience. When I was young, I spent a lot of time in the desert on my auntie's farm. This is a pet kangaroo. And that kangaroo taught me about cooling, because it used to wet its paws like this and then wipe behind its ears to cool itself down. It taught me about the muscles in legs and balance. It taught me about digestion, because if you didn't put charcoal in its milk, it would get really sick. It was a real hands-on learning experience. And I ask you to remember that image all the way to the end of this talk, please. This is the Aboriginal map of Australia. And before every talk or discussion we have in Australia, we usually recognise the indigenous owners of the land. And they wouldn't call themselves owners, they'd call themselves caretakers. But they've been on Australian soil for about 50,000 years. And they've learnt to live with it, by it, and belong to it. And this is their map of Australia. What their map of Australia does is it shows very clearly the sustainable and the unsustainable country, because each one of those countries is about the same population of people. There was roughly 1.1 million Aboriginal people in Australia when Captain Cook landed. Jimmy Cook, as the Aboriginal elders called him. This is the European map of Australia, which is radically different to the Aboriginal map of Australia, isn't it? And I think it was our first mistake as invaders of the land to break it up according to the wealth, so-called wealth, that is the minerals and the agriculture of the land, and not the temperament of the land at all. And this is a painting by an Aboriginal elder of Central Australia. That painting is 150 kilometres square. And it shows, in many ways, it shows the temperament of the people who walked the land, because they didn't see things necessarily. They saw things through their eyes, but they didn't see them as a painting through their eyes. They felt them through their body. So this painting's in plan. Whereas the European, this is the country that painting's from. This is a Google map of the country that painting's from. And those streaks in the painting of sand dunes in central Australia, in the desert land. And this is a European painting. This is Lloyd Rees, who was a great friend and teacher. But it's a very different way of seeing a place. And so already we've got people moving into a country and seeing it quite differently. Early Australian buildings, and remembering that Australia has only been occupied by Europeans for 200 years, were quite sensible. The first buildings that went up in Australia weren't too bad. They responded to climate, they were lightweight, they were transportable, they were built in off the floodplains, they had ventilators on the roof, they had verandas for shade because we've got a very harsh sun climate. But then the English influence started to come into play. And we started to build really silly buildings for Australia. Inappropriate buildings. And now we're building these sorts of buildings. Where the car, we build a edifice to the car. We celebrate the car. We don't celebrate the grandmother, we celebrate the car. And we face our building to the west because we've got blinds and we've got air conditioning. So it doesn't really matter what direction we face the building. At the advent of lifts and air conditioning and developers who wanted to make more money, we got high-rise buildings. Up until the 60s, high-rise were unheard. Well, not unheard of. They weren't held up a lot. 50s. But once we got air conditioning and lifts, it meant we could stack building upon building, and developers made it. In fact, there's a lot of families in Sydney and Melbourne who are beneficiaries of the developers that did these buildings. The high-rise city is a thing of currency at the moment, but why didn't we design them so they were thermal power stations? Why didn't we design them so we actually harnessed the sun and used it to power a city? At the moment, in Australia, we have a firm who's specializing in focusing the sun's rays on a mirror so that they can magnify the potential of those rays. And our wonderful government is saying, actually, we're not going to subsidise you, we're going to subsidise the coal industry. Because that's simpler and quicker for us. This is us going on a holiday. And we're sleeping in swag on the ground. We're comfortable. We're protected because there's a number of us. We don't have any animals that attack us. We have snakes, but they won't come into a camp like this. And so, at a very basic level, our lifestyle has a sense of freedom. Just as the Aboriginal people had. The Aboriginal people weren't savages. They were highly refined. They had one of the highest refined social networks you could have, interrelationships, personal relationships. And also one of the most refined languages. Of the 330 languages, all of them had that sort of refinement. And still today, the Aboriginal people act in similar fashions in Central Australia. Not everywhere, but in a lot of areas where they, and I was talking to someone about this today, they camp. So they put down a tent, they camp there, they forage, and they get food, and then they move on. It's a way of being in the country. And this is Aboriginal housing now. Shame on us. The other mistake that we made as Europeans was farming the country in a way that was unsustainable. Hard-hoofed animals on a very light soil doesn't work. Animals that require enormous amounts of water in a country that has no water doesn't work. And at the moment, this is what our government's encouraging. The local, the Minister for the Environment, Greg Hunt, has assured farmers in the Liverpool Plains region that the strictest conditions have been put into place to ensure ugly, noisy wind turbines do not blemish the new 35 square kilometre open-cut coal mine planned for the area, owned by the Chinese. So, our Minister for the Environment encourages this over this. So, there's been a lot of mistakes made in our country. And in fact, there's been a lot of mistakes made in all our countries. And we need to take stock because we're running out of energy sources. Sydney's in a basin, this basin here. Richard Karanek, myself, we live up on the Northern Peninsula, up the top there. But the Sydney Basin, if it had been paid attention to, the settlers would have seen that the Aboriginal tracks follow the ridges, and in fact the basin, by and large, is used for farming. But that's where we've got all our houses now. This is my mum and dad. So it's a family show. Mum, when I asked her why she used to take us to the desert, she said, "I want you to have the knowledge of the city and the truth of the country." My father used to say, "If you're going to do it once and do it right." This is the house we lived in as kids, and there are some students today asking me, "Can you tell us how you were brought up as a kid, Pete?" I said, "Sure, I'll tell you tonight." But what's interesting about this little sort of project house that my parents built was this room on the back, which is wasn't on the house when they first built it. And that room's a sunroom. And it was built by my dad. And it's where we live. We lived in this room on the back of the house, which is called the sunroom. And it became a common room in Australian culture, the sunroom. And for me, it was the clue to what sort of room we should be having to live in Australia. The other place I lived was here, which is Clareville Beach, where this is me and my brother, where we learned lessons like the patterns are caused by tidal change, or patterns like these patterns here, which are these patterns here, are caused by, in this case, soldier craft. So you learnt why things were formed. And you learnt how things were made and unmade. Because it was all there as it had been for millennia. The other place we learnt from was this desert property out here in the western region of New South Wales. These two properties between Jackamaru Range and this range through here. And it's semi-arid desert. So if you dig a trench in the ground, that trench stays there, the water changes direction because the land's so flat, and you get erosion within 6 months. It's beautiful country. And it changes radically, this country. When it's dry, none of the grasses are there, and it's just bright red soil. This is a little Aboriginal house that's on the property. It was carbon dated at about 1200 years old. So it's quite old. Not really old. And there's a hand stencil on the roof. So you can see just here above Bob's head, there's a hand stencil. And this is a plan of that house that you just looked at. So here's 50 metres, 25 metres. This is where the cave was. That's where the spearheads were found. Elvis making spears. That's where you could dig down about a metre and get water. bones from the animals they ate and carvings out of the tree for the containers, the remnants of that. This is the farmhouse now, which was completely off the grid for the first 17 years of my life. So we had water from the ground, we had water from the roof for drinking, we had a fire for cooking and a fire for heating, had a pit toilet and kerosene food. And this is where we stay when we go out there now. So this is our kitchen here, it's our living room and a bedroom just here. That's my eldest daughter in the bedroom sleeping in. And this is how I was educated and this is how I educated my kids. And this is how Rick and Karen's kids are. By being out there and being amongst it. These are some students that I took to the farm once, but the farm runs from this range all the way across to this range here. It's 100,000 acres. It takes me about 4 hours on a motorbike to go from one homestead to the next. And that ridge here comes down to this, the back here, which is a beautiful land ranch. And Rick always talks about Utzon referring to the landscape in his work. Well, this landscape I found occurring in my work, this particular one, and I'm sure lots of landscapes reoccur in work. And I heard Dr. Dushy talking to some students today and saying, these things come out unexpectedly. And if you pay attention and you look and you learn, you don't need to try and remember, it will happen. These are desert trees here. So they've got a big canopy and they've got a branch system that comes through a tap root. So the water drains down to one tap root. It collects at the bottom. The big canopy shades the ground and stops evaporation. They're common sense. They make sense. And of course the water's draining off the rocks and when it hits the dirt, that's where it stays and that's where the trees are. And when you're walking sheep through the landscape for days and days and days on end, you learn about them. You learn about moss and lichen being on the south side of the tree, not the north side, because the north side where the sun is. You learn about the moss being like this for years and years, 3 or 4 years on end until we get rain and then turning into that. So then you think to yourself, actually, we don't have seasons. We don't have four seasons. This is not a European country. In this place, we have seven seasons. And the seasons are, in our case, one of the seasons are acacia flowering. Another one is actually ants nesting in the Kurrajong tree. And because the country is so flat and hot, if you're a spider, and this is the third deadliest spider in Australia, the trapdoor, you make a hole in the ground which is a metre deep so you get about 8 degrees cooler, and then you make a little cap for it that's conical, and you put it over the top to hold the cool in, but if the water comes, which it will, the cap swells and stops the water getting in the hole. And all these things are references for your work. That's what I'm showing you. This is Gilgaya country. The Aboriginals call it Gilgaya country. It's the country where the water goes in the big wet. And these areas can be 600 kilometres wide in the centre of Australia. In this case, it's about 1.5 kilometres of Gilgaya country. And the water comes through here and sits at about 1 metre. High, and you generally get Aboriginal camps around this area. But what it is it's soaked country as well, so the water soaks through this country, cleanses its soaking, goes to the Artesian Basin. The Great Artesian Basin in Australia is the biggest Artesian Basin in the world. It has water in it carbon dated between 7,000 and 2 million years old. And it has 65,000 cubic kilometres of water, which we're now mining. This mine is on our property. Our property got taken by the miners because the government encourages it because they get 30% royalty. It got taken by the miners And that up there is a huge pond that's been pumped up from the Artesian Basin on country that we could never get water on. So I know in Australia we're making big mistakes, and I think around the world we're making mistakes, but I'm citing Australia in this case. So the riverbed up top is Sandy Creek that I have never seen flow up until 2009 when it flowed to about 2 metres. And it flowed 2010 as well. And at that time, frogs came out and spawned in the river, and I looked into those frogs because I thought, what the heck? That river's dry. How come frogs are out? And those frogs can survive underground for 7 years. So there's this whole sort of ecology of animals and microorganisms and fauna and flora that we have completely disregarded as civilized people. It's taken literally 350 million years to develop. And as I've said before, if the world is 1 year long, how long have humans been here? Any takers? 12 seconds. And I think we've used 50% of the world's energy in the last 50 years. So we farm country like this, and here's the poor old kangaroos trying to get something, a blade of grass to eat. And we ruin it. 2 seasons of farming this country like this, and it's unproductive. Right, that's the end of the sort of sad stuff. This is a house just here. Richard, Karen, Eck live over here, and I'm just building a little house just here. This house where the red dot is about 12,000 years old. This is how the land was subdivided on that peninsula. No reference to topography, water, anything. And this is the house. There were about 62 people who lived in this house. They lived there for thousands of years. And one end was a burial cave. There was water at that end, and the other end is where they lived. And the stains on the roof indicate sort of fire for cooking, but also they indicate how long the cave's been occupied. You can see 3 kids down the bottom there. But beautiful reference point, facing north, comfortable in winter, big overhangs in summer, thermal mass to keep the heat at bay, water running down the side, lovely place to be. Fire, water, the essential. And how, I said to someone yesterday, I said, do you guys collect your rainwater? No. How come? I don't know. I said, but if that water hasn't hit the ground, which is dirty, and you collect it off a clean roof, can't you use it? I guess so. These are vitamin C. They're not endemic to the area, but there are a series of trees at the front of the cave. And these are herbal remedy plants. And there was a big garden of them, about as big as this area here, this sea of people here, up the top of the cave. It was a house. And they used to fix their ailments with the stuff up the top. And they had water, food, and lived there for thousands of years. University was good fun. But what we did learn at university was we were surfers. We used to go around chasing the waves. This is Bell's Beach in Victoria. And we had surfboards on the roof, and we'd arrive at a place, and we'd have to choose a site. So we'd have to choose a site where the ants weren't, so they'd eat a pinch of food, out of the wind, so you didn't get the tent and the fire blown out, etc., etc. So we learned at early age how to choose sites, or how to look at sites. And we looked at place all around Australia. That was our first, I guess, our first adventure, was to look at the landscape and try and understand the landscape. And we lived with Aboriginal people, and we built some shelters with these people as a final year project at university. And even at the final year at university, which was 1978, We built a double skin wall with earth in between and then shutters above that were shut in winter to bring the heat in and open in summer to let the heat out. We used a double skin roof which span a foot and could ventilate. And then when I finished university, I went out and built some small things because I wanted to, Richard suggested to me it would be better to learn how to build and understand materials before I actually became an architect. So I did that for 5 years. I built this on the country farm, which is shearer's quarters. So they had a veranda. My cousin wanted to block in the veranda and use it for the shearers. And I said, well, why don't we build the beds out from the veranda, build some pivot walls on the veranda. When the shearers come, we'll shut the pivot walls. We'll put wool in the pivot walls to insulate the veranda. And the kids can use the benches as desks the rest of the year. So I went out and built that. I quoted my cousin $1,245 to build it, and it took me 6 months and cost me a lot more than that. And he kindly gave me a pair of riding boots. We're still discussing. I worked for a firm for 2 years. In order to get your professional indemnity, you have to work for. In order to get your professional license, you have to work for a firm. It was a wonderful firm, and in fact, the boss of that firm now works for me. Now, he works with me. He's a wonderful man, and he guides us beautifully on how to safeguard our buildings against silly builders and silly building problems and building issues and insurance issues. This is a Priotto structure we did. We did it in association with the Priotto representative. Priotto came out once and looked at it for us, and it was quite a wonderful project. And then I went to Papua New Guinea for nearly 2 years, and I lived in the highlands, and I lived with indigenous people up there, and I studied the longhouse, which is the building on the left, and I documented 45 different longhouses. Documenting a longhouse takes about a week. Fully documenting a longhouse. And it was probably one of the most informative periods of my life. I learned about humility, and I learned about people. I learned about accurate building. I learned about a crude structure. I learned about materials. I learned about living. It was wonderful. So on the left-hand side is the main longhouse, and then on the right-hand side some of my drawings have picked up. And this particular shot here, there were several of the kids building this building, and I couldn't understand how they knew how to build it. Because in the end, it's quite complicated. It's a double curved roof. And I sat there for about 2 hours watching them, and then I heard this yelling from the hill. And I turned around, there was an old guy sitting up on the hill. I call him the site architect, S-I-G-H-T. And he's yelling at the kids because they'd done something wrong. So they were being supervised after all. And this is the opening of the longhouse. And they have this to pay back all their debt. So there's the social issue to building in culture as well. Not just a physical and not just a metaphysical issue to building, but a social issue as well. So they invite all the neighbours, all the tribal neighbours, and they pay back all their debts by putting a big, long bench across there and sharing food with all the neighbors. This is a really beautiful room I woke up in once. It's in the highlands of Papua New Guinea, and it's a long, long house. It's about 120 meters long, and it's about 4.5-5 meters wide. And the light comes in through the floor. Incredibly beautiful. So you woke up in the morning and you're being lifted by the light up onto the ceiling. And the ceiling is lacquer black on the top from the smoke, and that black goes from a lacquer all the way down to a matte black on the side. And there's fires just blistering in the fireplace. It's all along the longhouse. And I think at that point I realized how architecture can be incredibly quintessentially simple. This is one of my first drawings of this building, which is a church, which we built. four of us in Papua New Guinea for 20,000 kina. And I left one weekend and we'd thrown out all these blocks here because they were off-cut from the concrete blocks, and we came back after the weekend and the kids had laid them out on the ground as paving. And I went, oh, sorry for wasting the concrete block. Good lesson. And these were my clients, the pastor and his wife and kids. And on my way back from Papua New Guinea, I hitchhiked back. I flew to Cairns and hitchhiked back because I had no money. I found this fellow who was an old school friend. And he was living in a little shed on a hill. And I knew he was somewhere in the bush there. And I saw a sign on the side of the road that said Gilbert's Wholesale Nursery. That's Nick Gilbert. So I asked the people I was hitchhiking with to stop the car. I got out of the car. I walked up the driveway about 400 metres. I got to the opening in the shed. He walked outside and he said, oh, Pete, I was just thinking of you. I've been away for 2 years. I was just thinking of you. I said, why? He said, we want to do a house. Can you do a house for us? So we did a house together, and that's my first house. And that was done in 1981. And then we started to work with builders. And we realized that that relationship, that symbiotic relationship between builder and architect, is one of the most important relationships you can have. So important to respect the process of building. And then we travelled a lot as well. So this is a great mutual friend of Rick Cowan and myself, Ponta Honda in Kyoto. And she shared her 400-year-old house with us. And we learned about small and little garden and sharing views and ceremony and accuracy and purity. And then I came back and built this house with my family in the trees overlooking the water. But it was very much in the spirit of the Papua New Guinean villages. Quite free. And this is how we live. This is my first child, Bronte. And then we won a competition and travelled, and the prize for the competition was an air ticket, so we opted to go to Africa and we hitchhiked through Africa for a year. And we lived in this village and a number of other villages from Kenya all the way down to South Africa. And then I got back to Sydney. I had no work. So the owner of this house said to me, why don't you build the house with me, Pete? I did. I built this little house with Ken. Great safety techniques in those days. You wouldn't be allowed to do that in Australia now. It would probably cost us about $20,000 in scaffolding on that house now. Safety scaffolding. But this is a tiny little project we built, which is this house. But it's actually a really simple, lovely little house. In fact, my office went there for lunch yesterday. I phoned them up to see how everything was going. They said, we can't talk, we're going. I said, where are you going? Oh, we're going to Ken's for lunch. I said, shouldn't you be working? So the roof follows the winter sun, and the top room is quite free and open to the landscape. The middle level has three openings, one to the bay, one to the waterfall and one to the rock ledge. And the bottom level is the wet area, but it's also the bracing for the building. And it's very much about the cave adjacent to it. My son did a drawing of it. And he's just finished third year architecture. And he's a lot better than Ollie. So, four things in architecture for me. A lot more, really, but four essential things. Space and light. Connection. Structure. And the really tricky one. The really hard one. The impossible one. Mood. There we go. perfect. Thank you.
No.
And I can finish if you like. Haven't seen any buildings yet. So, mood. Some reference buildings. Dad was an engineer, so structures were really important to me. Also, rural structures, because I spent so much time on the farm. This is a shearing shed in the Western Desert, built out of entirely out of 4x2, so 100x50 material, because the trees out there are so small. It's a beautiful building. This building here is power station, but every bit of steel works perfect. If you're going to save the timber on a door, then you put a little flashing over the top of it, and therefore you don't have to paint it. If you've got a benign environment, then why wouldn't you have a theatre that was outside? And you put a roof over in case it rains so you can all rush back there. We see these sort of skip bins in Australia and all around the world, and the amount of rubbish that goes away from a building site is usually more than the amount of material that goes into it. We have made a practice on camping on our sites to get to know the place. You don't need to do it as much now because you do understand things a lot better than when you were a kid. And since the 90s, or actually 80s, but 90s full-time, we've taught. This is Newcastle University, where Richard and I teach, and Karen has taught there as well. And we've been privileged to watch kids go from first year to final year, and to mentor them all the way through. And they're like family. An incredible experience. And this is masterclass. So what a privilege for me, the young guy, to work with Glenn Murkett, Mr. Laplastria, Lindsay Johnson, who is the Dean of Architecture at Newcastle University until he decided to start this alternate education system, and the wonderful Bitt Anderson from Norway, in Australia now. Incredibly talented people teaching outside the university environment, because the university environment was too stifling. And this is one of the places we teach. And we teach by drawing. No computers allowed. You remember that tonight. And so we draw. All sorts of drawings. Northwestern Australia. And we have the most wonderful Aboriginal elder, Max Dillamumman, who supports our system of teaching. The most gracious man, who says, in order to keep it, you've got to give it away. And wasn't that ironic that today Dr. Doshi said the same thing to me without him hearing that statement? That's what elders are all about. These people are great elders, and we've stopped learning from elders. But they're the teachers of the world. He's doing Welcome to Country here. So he's saying, you know, forget what you've seen and what you've heard and what has been said. Welcome to my country. Feel it. Be here. What a nice thing to do. These are the new teachers. Although, you know, the other day I went up to one of these and I was pretty emotional. I gave it a hug. Nothing. Zero. I'm a little bit worried about it. We've taught this is Hyderabad. This wonderful latte. Remember this? Mexico. This is teaching in Namibia. We arrived in Cape Town, we had to go all the way up to Namibia, Richard and myself, and we get to this amazing site with baboons all running across the top of the site, and we find this big rock here, and Rick runs up the top and he says, wow, we've got a performance space, and the the African students got up there and they sang. That's architecture. And they worked beautifully. These students, we followed some of these students through their course. It was wonderful. Norway. This is GA Gallery in Tokyo, where we get exhibited, which is nice. This is a masterclass we ran in Dublin, in Ireland. Lindsay Johnson and Rick and Yohani Plasma. And this is in Taiwan. This is some class in Taiwan. Does anyone recognize that? This is the director who is kind host of us at Falling Water, which is amazing. So what I'm showing is I'm showing the experience that you get through architecture. It's like an amazing poetry in your life. You get to see and do all these things. Nova Scotia, go studio. Teaching with Rick Joy. Kelly Roy, Colorado, running a masterclass. With the indigenous people in Chile. And of course you have to do a few buildings. So this is one of our early buildings. This is an early house. And what I'm going to do quickly with the buildings that I show you is just point out not the whole story of the building, because that would take all night, but just the things I learned from each building. The main thing I learned from each building. On this one, I learned about veranda. Veranda had been lost a bit in our culture because developers had come along and filled it in to get more floor space and get more money. And also veranda takes away the light. But if you put a polycarbonate section in your veranda, you can get light into the house still. Veranda is our outside room. In our culture and in your culture. I mean, look at this wonderful campus here. It's outside room. And that's all you really need in our climates. You don't need houses all locked up and clogged up with air conditioning and stuff. You need covered rooms. So there's this beautiful outside room here, and I designed these pivot things that just lifted up, so it became a big outside room. And that was a great lesson for me, reinstating the veranda as a room on the house. This was a competition we won for a design faculty. And this building is 2,000 square metres, but it's passively heated and cooled. So I've got big ventilators on the roof, and then we suck the air in down below through this thermal mass, and we cool the building. And in winter we shut it down and we've got a big northern facade with skins of tin where we heat the building. I got a call 18 months ago by the university and they said, we're going to have to put air conditioning in that building, Pete. And it's like 15 years old now. I said, why? And they said, it gets too hot. So I went rushing over there because we teach at this university. And I walked inside and it was hot. And I looked around and I said, have we got the vents open? And they said, what vents? So I went round and opened the vents and the place cooled about 10 degrees. They went, oh, right, vents. So this is inside that building. It's a very raw building. It was built very cheaply. This wasn't built very cheaply and it's not such a raw building, but it's an interesting building because it's a building in centre of Sydney, so it's right in the middle of Sydney. And it has this wall here, which is a trom wall, so two skins of glass with copper tubes. And the copper's oriented towards the winter sun and heats up to about 56 degrees Celsius. We take that down in the basement and store it in 10,000 litre tank. And then we use that with a heat pump to heat and cool the house. And then up on the ridge here, we've got 8 panels, which are 2x4. And we've got 4 of them with glass and 4 open to the sky. So you can actually open the ones with glass and heat the southern side of your building where the thermal mass is. And you can free ventilate it as well. So that building, which is 4,000 square foot, has no heating and cooling other than the passive one. Plus the structure cantilevers off the central wall, rah, rah, rah. There's a whole lot of other things. But the main lesson from that was on a big building, you can heat and cool it. And the cross ventilation comes through those windows under the roof, so the roof floats. So the roof hovers over the whole building. So if you took the walls away, you'd just have this big roof sitting there like an eagle or like a cormorant drawing its wings. This was a competition we came second in, which is a visitor centre over the Snowy Mountains River, where we used structure and then tied it back with some of their culverts. We tied it to the ground with their culverts. And then it's funny how things crop up later, isn't it? This is a little pavilion we did down in Kangaroo Valley where we lifted the roof up to the escarpment and to the sun. And then we made a big podium with the covered room opening onto the playing field. And then we shut the roof down. We wanted to heat it in winter, heat it quickly, so that's where the bedroom was. But this building was totally disassemblable. So you could actually assemble it and disassemble it in a matter of a week. And then we did a building for the Olympics, archery centre for the Olympics. This is landfill site, and it moves about 150 millimetres every 5 metres. So we designed the building like a centipede, so it could move as well. So it's designed in modules, with little moving parts in between the modules, and the roof is twisted, so that if there is movement, you don't pick it up in your eave line. But the twisting roof means you can catch the northeast breezes and put it down into the building. But it also means that it changes the scale under the veranda. So you get your ventilation too where your modules meet. And ironically, it was all built on an archery grid, which is a 6 metre grid. It was a 6 metre structure. Then we used a similar roof on a building where we wanted to catch the northeast breezes, which are our cooling breezes. But on this building here, the lesson we learnt was we put an outside kitchen in. And we hadn't really done an outside kitchen till then. And the outside kitchen is now in most of our buildings because that's where people love to cook. The mistake we made here is we didn't have a roof on it. But when you cook outside, you don't make a mess. Well, you do, but it's outside. So someone else can clean it up. And it was a really, really good thing to discover that a kitchen can be outside. So here's, and this is like a warehouse building. So here's a big single space with a pantry, and then there's a big area for sleeping up here and with clothes. So there's two rooms within two big rooms, or one big room. So it's a warehouse house. And then we won a competition to do a life sciences building, which is about 40,000 square foot, and it's all precast concrete. So if you really wanted to, you could disassemble it. But it would cost you a bit. That's 1,200 tonnes of cantilevering concrete. Cantilevering 22.5 metres. And we developed a system where all the services were on the side of the building. So all the services for this building on a walkway on the side. So you can walk along and service the building without going into it at all. So the building's still functional. This is a house on the side of Sydney Harbour, where it's on the typical sandstone ridgeline, where you get little pools of water that sit on the rock ledges and they sparkle in the late afternoon sun. And it's just a simple concrete frame. I call this the concrete tent. And then it's infilled with standard panels. These are chicken shed panels. So they're off-the-shelf panels. They're raw panels. And then we had some standard door systems, and that was it. But it relates really beautifully and simply to the landscape. And it's designed not to go across the site, so it blocks everyone's view, but it's designed to go with the site so you can see through the building all the way to the water. And it has an outside kitchen, which is covered, note the lesson. And the whole downstairs area opens. And this is my client's bedroom and the art gallery. So he sleeps with his art. And you look from the living room across to the art. So you look from the living room on the left across the art on the right. Nice thing to do. And this is a building that, again, was won by competition. It's the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders cultural centre, multicultural centre. It was done with Richard, myself, and Sue Harper, three generations of architects who worked with me and I worked with Richard. And we had the most wonderful client. Three Aboriginal elders who guided us through the process. no air conditioning in a big building. And I said, we don't want air conditioning. We just want to open the windows, shut the windows. And we want to catch the water and put some fish in a pond so we can catch them for lunch. Really? Yes, we do. We want to put a garden out here of herbal remedies, of natural herbal remedies, and food that we can eat. We want to have a kitchen on the outside so that we can have our friends over for a barbecue. This is a university building. We want the building to be like a house, not a university building. We want a big room somewhere, but in this case in the center, to have all the local elders, who are not university students, but they're elders, to come in and teach our university people. And in the middle of that room is a big fireplace. And last time I was there, which would have been 6 weeks ago, they were throwing big logs onto the fireplace. That's the university building. And it's all passively heated and cool. So the air comes from downstairs, it comes up here in this big fly roof, which is 600 deep, it ventilates the whole building. And in winter, we shut the fly roof and it heats the whole building. And we've never, ever had a complaint from these people about heating and cooling. We've had a complaint from the other building, the big concrete one, which are the doctors. We've had a complaint from them, but not the Aboriginal people. Then I thought, well, you know, if you can live in a covered room outside on a veranda, maybe the whole house can be outside. So this is a house on the Central Coast above Sydney, where this wall here has all the services in it, or secondary services. So it's got kitchens, bathrooms, storage areas, laundries, wash areas, so you can come back from the beach. The wall on the left-hand side you open up. The building on the right-hand side has a kitchen and living area as well, and you can basically live outside with a bit of cover. All the bedrooms and that are beyond the building, but they only go there at night time and they live in the courtyard. So this was taking that whole idea of an outside room or outside living a step further. And then again, in this building here, which is in Newcastle, where we teach, we had a big party there one night and old Uncle Max was sitting on that table. And I said, Max, why don't you come inside for the party? He said, oh, no. This is the best room in the house. But because this house is so big and it faces north, it gives you shadow to the south. So we made that a courtyard, or the back lane, as Rick calls it, and we put, because it's a cut into the ground, we put all our services in this wall here, and you walk across walkways to go to your bathrooms and your laundry and service areas. But all the services are in the ground where it's wet. So this back lane has a glass roof on it. And in winter that heats up and we've got drop blinds that keep the heat in. And in summer we've got gardens at either end that we have mist sprays in and we cross-ventilate the house. And we cool it. And this is a house where all the facades of the house relate specifically to their immediate and distant view in terms of landscape. So this pond here has mist sprays in it. This is the northeast side, so the wind goes through here into the house and cools it. The roof lifts up to the mountain, acknowledges the mountain, and then it drops down to the west where you get your fires and your bad winds from. It's a single pitch so we can collect water. This is in a fire zone, so you've got to collect water, 100,000 litres of water. And then on the other side, it's got all your thermal mass, but it relates to a little gully that drops off to the south. So it's a very connected house, this one. And I should have more of these drawings, but these are the little sketches I do in order to get a plan done. So it's an idea sketch, and I was saying to the students today, they were asking, you know, how do you know when your idea is, you know, good enough? And my response was, because the sketch feels right. If you do your research and you understand what you're doing and you look at place and you listen to your clients, eventually you know that feeling of when it's right. And that's that building, which is out in a paddock outside Canberra. And it's built, it's a prefabricated house. But the idea was I put all the thermal mass in the middle. So I put outside kitchen, library, storage and everything in the middle between two walls. And then just build two lightweight frames outside those walls to live in. This was built for about half price, this building. And then this building was built like this because it's right next to a little creek river, just here, and it floods up through here, but the ground is always wet. And so if you build on wet ground, it comes through the ground, through the floor of your building, into your building, and always feels wet no matter what you do to it. So we lifted that off the ground. But the other problem we had here was that the sun gets low in winter across the top of the trees here and comes parallel to this house, and it's very hard to get sun into it. So we made the house just one room deep and made a structural corridor, and we bounced the light off the structure of the corridor into the single room. So that became the architecture. And then here's our covered room here. And the covered room opens the kitchen living area, and it also opens the bathroom, but not the toilet. So when it's a family, just your own personal family, you can have the bathroom open, where you have your bath, the kids have the bath. Your covered room and your kitchen, you can all be living in one big open room. And when people come, you just shut the doors. And then this was another experiment in prefabrication, where we built one big roof, and we built a little wedge shape under the roof, and the negative space of the wedge was the veranda for the building. And then we built these big blades here, which are 5.5 meters high, and they open in winter and they put sun on the floor, which heats the building, and they shut in summer. It was that simple. And that building was built similar to that little framed one in the paddock, about half price. And then this is the wool shed we got asked to do. The client phoned us up one day and he said, "Pete, I'm in a shed. It's 38 outside and it's 45 degrees inside the shed. Can you do me a shed that is cooler than the outside temperature?" I said, "Yeah, no worries." Very confident. But the most important thing about this building was choosing the site. If I had not gone to the site, I would have made a complete mistake. Because what happened is that little hill in the background, the wind hits that hill and it comes around almost at 90 degrees to the wind direction. So if I hadn't been there and stood there and felt that, I would have got the building completely wrong. And so it comes in on this side of the building. So we orientated the building so the wind came in on the side. And we have 9 sprinklers on the roof. We catch all the water off the roof in a dam down here and pump it back to the building. We have these screens on the side of the building and we run water down the screens. The air comes through the screens and cools the building. And because the building is shading the ground is always very cool, so we take that cool air and we cool the building. We reduce temperatures in the building by 10 to 14 degrees Celsius, passively, and we heated the building by taking the heat off the sheet. Like at the moment, we're all producing all this heat up here, which is being lost. We kept that heat, and we blew it over the shearers. So all our drawings, if you really look at them closely, they're all very practical drawings. They're like direction of the wind, heights for loading the truck, what angle you need to take the roof to keep the sun out, direct sunlight, the sheep don't run in direct sunlight. They're all very practical. These are the clients who are amazing people. They work their butts off, these guys. And they call this the resort. These were the other clients. Not a word, not a complaint from these ones. Not a bad word. But you can see here the little drop ceiling. So the heat comes off the sheet, we catch it in this drop ceiling, and then we take it to the other side over here and we blow it back down on the shearers. We take the cool air from under here and run it past the shearers in summer. And other than that, the building's fairly direct. The walls were of the right height, bales. The screen on the side of the building where we run water down the screen. We catch the water on salt bush so the sheep can eat the salt bush, but when the salt bush is wet, it catches all the dust. So the dust doesn't go into the shed. It's just a practical building, really. Put the water tanks on the cold side of the building so they don't heat up. Put the one dust screen on the north where the dust comes from. And this is a building overlooking the water that you can see out here, but it faces south and we get our sun from the north. Freezing cold site, this site. And below the road, so the sun only got there at about 10 and it left at 3. So it wasn't a very comfortable place to live. So what we did was we made a polycarbonate roof, 15 millimeters polycarbonate, 16 millimeters, five cells, five air cells, and we brought all the sunlight in through the roof. A big warehouse building. So a single roof, bring the sunlight in, and then design your scallops so they keep the sunlight out in summer. And that's the aesthetic. We did a cardboard house, the House of the Future, in 2005. And we used that material, which is the roofing material of the shearing shed, we used that material for an airport hangar, but we turned it in the other direction in order to see if we could reduce the structure of the building. We reduced the structure by 70%. We decreased the cost of the airport hangar by about 50%. So you can see all we've got is four trusses and a roof panel structure. We did a house more recently on the western shores overlooking Pittwater where we used the cliff as the back wall and the thermal mass for the house. So we had this big rock ledge behind the house, and rather than covering it up, we trimmed it where it had been damaged, which was just here, and then we exposed it in the house. Then we put a gap, you can see, between the floor and the rock ledge, and we took air in below, at the bottom of the rock ledge, and we brought it up past the rock ledge in summer and absorbed took the temperature out of the air and cooled the house. And in winter we closed the stairwell and heated the house with a glass corridor. This is the top room of that house. This house has a big, like, umbrella canopy roof that actually doesn't sit on the roof of the ceiling at all. This house here has a structural corridor. This corridor here is a structural corridor. It's also a thermal corridor. It faces west where we get our bushfires from. And it's a big long room essentially. It's not a corridor, it's a room. 2.2 wide, and it has studies, changing areas, and bed alcoves in it. So these little pop-outs on the side here, which are bedrooms as well. So the house was for two families, and these are bathrooms that come off the corridor. And it had big pivot doors in it, so you could shut the corridor down and make separate houses, really. The other story about Vermeule that you didn't tell was that, in fact, we did a competition in 2008, an international steel competition, and Sandep and Vermeule were shortlisted, along with us, for a steel house in Russia. And we had a great time in Helsinki, and we became very good friends. And as a consequence of that, I came to Bangalore to do some lecturing. But unfortunately for Sandip, we won. But nevertheless, great times. These were our clients in Russia. Tough clients. The guy on the left-hand side didn't speak any English and really didn't want to build our house. The woman on the right-hand side, I have got no idea what she did. She looked good at the dinner table. But we looked at the traditional Russian houses, and just here is a big oven where they used to cook the bread. And the brickwork was this thick. And it was in all the monasteries as well. They used to heat these up during the day and get them red hot, and they'd radiate heat all night time. And that's where they did all their cooking. So we took that as a clue, and we made a central wall as a radiator. It was a steel competition, so this was a steel wall, 16 millimeter steel. And it had all the light fittings, all the things that produce temperature. It had the hot water system, hot water pipes, had everything, the refrigerator, the gas stove, everything in the central wall. And then we had a radiator floor as well, which is a combination of steel and timber. And then we had thermal mass in the wall. We put some thermal stones in the wall as well. So what we did was we reduced all our heat from this wall. We kept it isolated from the walls, which you've got to do. And then we did a structure that took the heat by twisting the air up to a ridge line where we caught it and put it back down again into the wall. We recycled 90% of the heat in the building. We increased efficiency of heating these buildings by 64%. And they've now built a whole lot of these buildings in the compound, in their compound. Not particularly well, but they're built. When we were doing this competition, the office was working late at night and not very happy. And I said, look, if we win the competition, I'll take you to Japan. It was a very expensive thing to say. All the money for the competition went in airfare, which is great. So here we are in Japan visiting a house that we just did in Japan. We finished in Japan in 2010. And it was for a wonderful man, a fashion designer, an incredibly creative man, who taught me a heck of a lot about design, about resolve, about order, about saying less than more, and about discipline. This is the plan of the house. All our plans are drawn by hand. Nothing on computer at presentation stage. So there's an urban environment here. There's a samurai house and a geisha house over there. We built a wall to the street. The wall was the cave. And then we just lent a tree onto the wall. And we had a couple of gardens in between the private and the public area. Very simple building. But as you know, very simple buildings become complicated. That was the client, one of our happy moments. And that was the wonderful team I worked with in Tokyo. You know, it was interesting because the client was so famous. Every time I phoned a Japanese architect that I'd been recommended to work with, they went, oh, we'd love to do it, but no thanks. And I thought, oh, my reputation goes before me. They don't want to work with us. But the reason they didn't want to work with us is if you make a mistake for a great person in Japan, not too much work anymore. This guy on the left-hand side, KG, took the chance. He was a young bloke. He's an leading industrial designer, making great steel chairs. And just wonderful. Just so good to work with. His assistant, Honto, who went down to the site every week for us and sent us photos and get on the phone and Skype us. And wonderful Olivia, who is the in-between. The client spoke fluent English, fluent French, and fluent Japanese. And as a consequence of the building, came to Sydney and studied architecture and finished last year. He was a fashion designer up until then. Lots of models, 26 different models for this building. So you can see the wall against the street and then the open pavilion in front. And where the wall was against the street, it was also against the sun, the winter sun. We had plenty of thermal pool, thermal ponding heating, 86 degrees Fahrenheit. So we didn't need the heat. What we needed was the light, the sunlight, in order for the building to flicker and feel alive. So we had a skylight between the roof and the wall to the street. And we put a skin of water on the wall and bounced light through the skylight in winter to get that sense of warmth. So it came on top of this and bounced into the building. There are sliding panels here, canvas panels that shut this side down, which means you can open and heat it, any part of the pavilion beyond. And it also means as you change the scale and the quality of the rooms remarkably. The roof has a twist in it, which follows the contour of the land, but also means that you can, like with the Russian house, you can pull air through the building a lot easier. And that's why the windows or the ventilators on the ridge line there. All the services down the left-hand side. Single skin timber construction. We did all the light fittings. The doors shut on the centre line of the block work, so it means the light goes either side of the door. There's the covered room that has been in all the buildings. bathhouse on the left-hand side. No artificial lighting, just candles. And there's the panel for sliding all the doors to the outside of the building. We designed the light fitting and the bath fitting. And we connected the building with the rest of the site with a lovely pool of water and an extended porch. And this is where what the client wanted is he wanted three areas. He wanted a private area, a public area, and a social area. So this is the public area where the public can come in from the street, they can sit at this table, they can look at his garden, they can share a cup of green tea or a glass of wine, and then they can go, or he can invite them into the social area on the right-hand side, and then he has the private area on the left-hand side. So it's a very sort of egalitarian building in that sense. And that's how it sits in the garden. This is a development of that idea where we were asked to do a dining room, so we just did a roof in the garden. And we said, can't you eat under that? And thank goodness they said, yes, they could. So you can see our wonderful client. It's the second building for these guys. We did a building 20 years ago for them. And this is our second building, which has joined the old building with the new building. You can see Robbie sitting there under the roof. And I'd say 7 out of 10 times I go to visit, they're out in the garden in the dining room. That's the building up the back, which is a design building we did about 25 years ago. And that's the garden room where the dining room is. It was designed to have drop blinds that sit just here and here, but we didn't put those in because they're not needed. And then this is a building on the escarpment or on the hill line of our Great Dividing Range, which is a tiny range that divides sort of the Sydney Basin from the Western Slopes and Western Plains and the desert all the way to Perth. So this site, when the winds are blowing from the west, this site gets hammered by hot winds. When they're blowing from the southwest, you get snow across this site. And when they're blowing from the east, they come up the Megalong Valley and they hammer this building. So it had to be a tough building. We dropped it below the ridge line so we were getting out of that wind. We put a skin of water on the roof, which you can see just there, to insulate it, but also to give it lightness because you approach this building from above. Because we dropped it so far below the ground, we used these here as light and sun scoops. And where we didn't need them is that we used them as bedrooms. But they sit quite nicely as sculptures in this water garden, and they line up with the mountains in the distance. Quite nice. And then we rolled the roof against the landscape, so we didn't want a hard line against the landscape. But what that meant is the back corridor got a variation of light in it, and it's an art gallery, which is quite nice because you can change your art according to the light that comes into the back corridor. And we picked up on the local character of the area, which was limestone cave. So these are the big sunlight scoops, very simple plan, covered room in the middle of the building, totally operable building, and the central wall. I think it was Louis Kahn who said, you know, the greatest buildings are great ruins. So this building was certainly thought about as a ruin. So all our services are in the central core. This building was built over 3 years by one builder and his two apprentices. They did everything on the building bar the electrics and hydraulics. This is a more recent building. It's a very recent building actually, it's just been finished. The client came to us and he said he wanted a big building. He's a single man, but he has an amazing art collection. And it's actually a very valuable, incredible Asian art collection. And he said, I want to build a house, but I want it to eventually be an art gallery. And eventually I want to give it to the nation. Interesting. So the idea behind the house is that it's his house while he's alive. his brother can use it for, I think there's a 10-year period after he dies, and then after that it gets given to the nation as an art gallery. So we designed it as an art gallery. So this is sort of the sculpture court, and this is where you enter. North is up in that direction. We don't site buildings according to north, we site buildings according to site. And then we orientate the building according to north. So what we did was we simply opened a rectangular plan up like that to the north. And of course we put our living up in that end. And we put no second floor in that end so that the sun can penetrate right the end of the building. And that's why the roof twists like that. No other reason. So that's the north end of the building where the floor stops two bays beforehand. We made a very big structure as our columns. I always get frustrated when the structure is done and it looks so beautiful, then you bring all the joinery and the fit out in and you diminish everything. So we made the structure big to match the joinery, but we also put all our services in the structure. So we put a service duct in the middle of the column. We collect hot air and drag it down into the basement. We also have our hydronic heating in the columns as well, so they become radiators. And that's from the top of the building. So the top of the building is his private area with his private gardens at quite a different scale. And that's the north end there. And that's the southern end of the building. So, nearly there. This is our most recent house, which is the house on the cliffs of Sydney. So these are the cliffs of Sydney, just on the North Head, near North Head. This is the house just here. We took a boat beyond the cliffs to look back at the site. And we went and stayed on the site for a while. And also a friend of mine had done a house near here, and he'd used a curved wall in one instance. And what that said to me, this is Neil Durbat, what that said to me is the softness of a curve on this very dramatic site is really beautiful. So I told him I was going to use his idea. But what we did was we did a really soft curved building on top of this pediment, which is just a big rock platform. And we lifted it off the rock platform so it didn't sit heavy of it and diminish it. So it was very transparent at ground level. And then we made it a really tough building because you get winds that hit this cliff and they roar up the side of the cliff and they hit the building at about four times the speed that they were at the bottom of the cliff. So it had to be a tough building as well. But where we lifted off the ground, we just put a little pavilion underneath the building, a glass pavilion, and we put four courtyards either side of it. So you just open the pavilion onto the courtyards and that's where you live. So that was one of the drawings as an idea. But because you're building two horizontal plates, you get the problem of a constant scale. So we really littered it or dotted it with skylights. And then we put little foils in those skylights to change the scale. Precast panels on the outside. The plan is very central on the outside, but underneath that is very regular. All the structure is designed according to its seismic loading. So there are some columns, there's one column which is 900 and the rest are 450 or 300. So it's a very simple but I think quite workable little building. I think that's my favourite elevation. This is a water tank that we use as a plunge pool. And this is a connection all the way through to the sky so we can get the register of what's going on in the day in the pool, be it reflection of clouds or the dots of rain or the wind moving across the water. These are pipes that wouldn't fit in the slab, so there's sculptures sitting on the bottom of it. That's the wall to the cliff. And the cliff has this lovely movement, and so does the wall. And the wall forms a veranda for the rooms below. And the whole thing opens up. And there's a combination of three materials on the wall, copper, glass, or concrete. So it should be there for about 120 years, untouched. And that's your register to the sky. And this, of course, was extremely difficult. It was a faceted wall, and we made it white where you wanted privacy for the bathroom and clear where you wanted light. And then we had to develop a window system, which is a polycarbonate with a pivot window. It's a really pared-back building, this building. It's like that concrete one I showed you from the side of the harbour, but with a little bit more decoration, done with John Boheme, a wonderful architect. You can see here we used woks in the ceiling to create a recess, and eventually we had those woks enameled and we dropped them down as a light fitting. This was made by a builder who's made several houses for us. Everything was kept off the ceiling below, so that's a service duct there, so the whole thing, lower thing floated, or the building floated over the lower room. All single skin timber on the inside, because you had to work with curves, so single skin timber does work with curves. And then exposed copper fittings, because you don't have a cavity. So you have to design all your fittings to be exposed. But you just use the plumber to make them, so it's cheap. And then, because the central corridor could be dark, you make a glass wall to the bathroom and bring light through that wall to the stairwell. And this is where you start changing the scale of the room underneath with your skylight foils, which all vary depending on where they are. Here's an her mirror. All the basins are made by a potter friend. These basins through here. And we call those the serviette light field. We gold foil plated the recesses, the light recesses. That's the bathroom. And we just put a thin copper sheet where the shower is on that curved timber wall. And we put red glass to get privacy. So you can see there on the left-hand side is the hot water pipe, which is also the towel rail. That's the window that took that. Because it's two facets, it was a lot harder to do than the one-facet window. And I don't think there's anything wrong with using curtains. They're very practical. And the one wonderful sort of thing that came out of the curve, which you never anticipate, is how it plays beautifully with the horizon. And we had to change that skylight to a block skylight because the gentleman of the partnership was complaining that the full moon kept him awake at night time, which I thought was a great complaint. We designed the door fittings. And we designed the furniture. That's a couch work desk that we designed. All the furniture in the room. That's the project architect and the builder. And a pair of socks. Great people. Can't do it without them. And you meet amazing people along the way. This is wonderful Sir Ian Apfield, who died in January. One of the great architects of the world. A great character, a great raconteur, a great friend of Richard's and myself, and Kate. And taught us so much about humanity. A great friend we've just been teaching with in Vermont, Rick Joy. Met him in 2002 and have been close ever since. An old master, Kenneth Frampton. A young master. And just a couple of competitions. This is a temple in Papua New Guinea that hasn't been announced yet. It's a Baha'i temple. What they have in prerequisites for Baha'i temples, there's a dome and nine sides. And I'm not sure if you know Baha'i temples, that they're usually incredibly decorated and complicated. Our temple is simply some pleats that are different sizes according to the light and the wind that you want in. A dome which is horizontally made, so it's laminated horizontally, which you can see in the model. And then inside, all we've got is a fine filigree of timber that runs around and creates the nine bays beyond it. And it all sits on a bed of 200 millimetre of water, cut slightly into the top of the mountain. You can see the filigree timber there, 45 metres diameter. Piles on the outside. And this is a competition that we won, and it's being built at the moment. This is an old nurse's quarter, and they wanted to turn it into an arts centre. And the arches on it, I mean, you'd find this ironic, you guys, that were heritage listed because they're like 60 years old. And I went, yeah, really, 60? And we're having trouble heritage listing a fish trap by the Aborigines, which is about a kilometre square, that is 10,000 years old. We're having trouble listing that. And this gets listed. Anyway, I said, not as a joke, but sort of tongue-in-cheek, I said to Belinda in the office, I said, what we should do is just ram 7 big barrel vaults through those arches. Just straight through the arches, rip out everything underneath the barrel vaults, make a big outside room, end of story. So we did that, and we won the competition. So this is out for tender at the moment, but these are big arches that run into the building. We took out the guts of the building underneath them, and just a lovely sort of perimeter walkway where you walk through the arches and they become artisans' rooms. And then this was a competition I put in the day before we left to come away, which is just a surf club. So it's an elevated tile. This is all tiled, so it's tiled walls and tiled roof on big round columns. And it's just a surf club for some women surfers who save people's lives. So that this hasn't been announced either. But very simple building. And there's bunks on the left hand side, 2 levels of bunks on the left and 1 level of bunk on the right. And this is where we live. So this is my house, Fernanda and I, and Cleopatra and Noah, and Bronte sometimes. It's a South African tent. It costs $5,700. And in fact, the deck that it sits on costs more. But it's fine. And we've been there for just under 2 years. Kitchen out the back. Beautiful bedroom. Bathroom on the other side. Little bit cold in winter. But you get in the hot tub, which is out in the paddock, and you're fine. And the block of flats next door doesn't say a word. So this sort of stuff can't be done without an amazing team. And I've had over 100 people work in the office over the years. This is the current office. And there's Neil, who I used to work for. Third from the right, and Belinda, who runs the office when I'm not there. In fact, that's where I swim every morning, in that pool. And you remember the kangaroo? That's how we learn about kangaroos now. Thank you.